Alan Thompson.
Alan Thompson.
BBC Radio Wales.
It's the Alan Thompson Show here on BBC Radio Wales. My special guest on the programme tonight is a musical legend, somebody that I've spoken to a couple of times over the years, and I'm a huge fan of Andy Partridge from XTC. I'm sat in his living room drinking tea, looking at his stuff, and it's a great pleasure to have Andy on the programme. Isn't it, Andy?
Yeah, I wish you wouldn't be looking up my stuff.
Welcome to BBC Radio Wales. You've been fairly quiet for a while, but you've got loads of stuff on the go. Tease me with some of the things that are happening.
Well, taking this purple feather duster, I shall tease you with, we're slowly working through the XTC catalogue and having it mixed as surround. We've got Nonesuch out there already, the 92 album, which is all sounds absolutely lovely and sounds even more amazing when it's you're right in the middle of it. The Drums and Wires album from, when was Drums and Wires? Yeah, 79. That's been done and that's almost ready to escape its shackles and get out there.
And I guess a lot of these songs you haven't heard for a long time because you don't sit at home in your house where we are today in Swindon, endlessly listening to old XTC records.
I never listen to XTC. The only time I can listen to XTC is if I ever get incredibly drunk. I might say to myself, you know what, let's get the old records out. And then I'll put some headphones on so I don't annoy the neighbours. And then I'll put an album on I haven't heard for years and years and years and then probably pass out in 5 minutes as I'm thinking, you know, these are quite good. You know, so I'm not in the habit of listening to my own music.
So what's it like when you put on a record and a bunch of songs that you wrote when you were 23 or something? Is that quite a strange experience for you going back there?
It is. The older they are, the more like teenage photos they are. You know, with teenage photos, you think, oh my goodness, look at the trousers, look at the cut of those trousers, look at those shoes and the pimples on him or the hairdo. And it's kind of like that with the music, some of it. You know, because you when you're inside that music making it, you have a different take. You don't see it from outside. You have a different experience. That's the same for anybody. If you know actors who are in films can never see that film the same as somebody who just turns up at the cinema and buys a ticket, you know. The later things, I think we get pretty decent, and you know, the later recordings, like anything from the last half a dozen albums, I'd be immensely proud of.
Well, let's pick some songs. Let's pick some of your favourite songs on the programme tonight. You can have anything at all from the songs that you've written over the years. The more obscure, the better, really. What do you fancy starting with? Some of Andy Partridge's favourite XTC songs.
My goodness. How about one that I think I seem to put my finger on? My own spirit, my own spirit of optimism, which is completely misplaced, and I don't think has ever been of any use to me. But I'm pretty optimistic, and there's a number on the album Wasp Star called "We're All Light," and I think it manages to pin completely my absolutely useless spirit of optimism. I won't take from you.
Someplace. It's the Alan Thompson Show here on BBC Radio Wales. That's We're All Light from XTC from the Wasp Star album. And my special guest on the programme tonight chatting to me about what he's up to and about his lengthy career.
I bet everybody was boogalooing around their sheltered accommodation to that.
Is Andy Partridge out of XTC, who's wearing the most extraordinary trousers.
These trousers, and thank goodness it's not colour radio, these trousers were given to me on my last trip to the very interesting country of Japan, when this fellow who was in a band over there, he spoke no English, so through an interpreter, the interpreter said he's a big fan of your band and he'd like to give you a present. And he gave me this kind of, I think the Americans call it a leisure suit. Basically a big baggy pair of cotton trousers. And I think the poor soul bought the largest pair he could find, but they're still too damn short. Because, you know, I've got really long gangly legs. But very nice of him to buy them for me. Because it's hot today, I thought, well, I'll break them out and go all cool in the Netherlands down here.
Yeah. And they're topped off with a nice pair of Doc Martens.
Yeah, Doc Martens are a little heavy for this weather, but I have to wear something that kind of fills the gap between ankle and lower shin because the trousers are too damn short.
It's a good look. What's the current state of XTC now? Is it done and dusted? Is it all finished, or is it on hold, so to speak? What's happening there?
We never split. No. I don't see myself getting together with the other chaps anytime soon, because I think we did our thing, and everything has a sell by date, a use by date. You know, and my goodness, didn't we have a long run? You know, we had a career that in the public eye from halfway through 1977 to about halfway through 2007.
Are you not a fan of the early albums then? Because you said earlier on that you thought the later stuff was your best collection. But when you listen to Drums and Wires, when you listen to the really early stuff, are you not a fan of that stuff? Black Sea in particular, perhaps?
It's fine, because if you're not in the band, you get a totally different view of something. To me, when I would write a song, or when we would make an album, that's like a personal thing. I want to be better.
Because you were the early part of XTC's career between 77 and 82 is when you stopped touring. You toured endlessly, a big live attraction. So many people wanted, and still do to this day, to achieve what you achieved. You were genuine pop stars. How did you find that when it actually happened to you? Was it what you expected it to be?
No, to be frank, it was. I think in your naive little head, when you've never done it before, you think it's going to be a hard day's help.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be a hard day's help, monkeys. And it's not like that at all. You don't all live in one house because you spend all day in one van. And if he blinks like that again, I'm going to kill him. You know, you don't get that on Hard Day's Night. It's this weird, unnatural life where you're permanently exhausted, you permanently eat badly, you're permanently trying to relax yourself after a show. So you're sort of, you know, like, just hold my mouth open while I tip all this booze in, please, because I need to relax, because we got to get up at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning and fly 2,000 miles to another. And it's already 2 o'clock in the morning and I'm so zoomed up after that gig. If I don't do something to relax, I'm never going to sleep. So it's really artificial and it's very stressful. Yeah. And you think, yeah, I want to be rich and famous. Well, forget rich. You never see any money. I mean, it's no lie to tell you that in 5 years of solid touring all around the planet, the band XTC never saw any money from any of those shows. And you can stand there on stage and you think, hang on, there's 20,000 people in this stadium or whatever, this venue, and they've all paid X dollars to get in. That's rather a lot of money. Why am I not seeing any of that? or you know, and you're actually thinking this on stage. You've got 30 seconds before you come back in with a harmony line or your little solo kicks in or whatever it is, and you find your brain wandering to mundane stuff like that. But it does trouble you that you're killing yourself on the road for the financial benefit of other people.
But you did have a lot of fair amount of hit singles.
The hits were not so much singles. We had sort of what you'd call sort of semi-ish hits in England, you know, things that were in the top 20. But really our biggest success came later, after we'd stopped touring, in America. In England, our career in the mid-80s was completely dead.
Well, it was weird because you were making terrific records. After you stopped touring in 82 with English Settlement, you were making terrific records, but the hits dried up, didn't they? And because you weren't out on the road, you weren't seen as that big a deal anymore.
We couldn't get arrested. Because we weren't out on the road touring around in clubs and halls in England, it was like, well, they don't exist then. And TV shows would never think to have us on. You know, programs like The Tube, they came down here to do an interview almost before their last program, and they said, look, we realized that we've never asked you on in all these years. And this was not unusual. We just seemed to fall between the cracks for a lot of people in the media world, and which was a shame, because, like I say, our albums were getting better and better. Yeah. But we couldn't get arrested in England. But oddly, in Japan, our career was getting more and more, you know, it was getting better and better. And in America, all of our albums were like number one in what they called the college charts, or the alternate charts, because American charts are split into so many different strata, you know.
You stopped touring in 82, and it's been well documented that you personally had enough of that, and the band didn't tour after that. Has there ever been a time, Andy, where you fancied getting back on stage?
No, because to be truthful, I never wanted to be the front man in a band. I always wanted to be the kind of Keith Richards fella, you know, the one who wasn't doing the singing and could just strum the guitar and write the stuff, and there would be someone else who would take the attention.
Would you ever get back on a stage now, do you think? Because if Andy Partridge did a live gig or a small tour, that would be huge, I think. People would love to see that.
But like I said, I never wanted to be the lead character. Yeah. And I found myself just having to be this by default. Mm. And I had to bully Colin into singing as well. I said, look, I need a harmony line here. Or can you sing this along with me? Oh, I don't want to sing. You know, and I thought, come on. And I'd really bully him into singing. Right. But I never wanted to be the one where all the attention was on. And I was ill cut out for it. Mm. I thought, I'll just write the songs and I'll stand to one side. But no, I ended up as being the sort of main man out of default. It wasn't totally in my makeup. And when I did stop touring because I of all this Valium addiction that I had to get out of my system, and things, you know, when you go cold turkey on a heavy duty drug like Valium, and you've been taking for 13 years, things go wrong, you know, things come undone. And I was getting memory loss. I was getting, you know, I'd be in a hotel in America somewhere on tour, and I'd have to ring down the reception and ask who was in room 212, please. Oh, that's a Mr. Partridge. Oh, thank you. Then you'd remember who you were. Or my limbs wouldn't work. You know, you'd be having a little lie down before the sound check or something, and couldn't get off the bed because you couldn't make your knee joints or your elbow joints work properly, and weird symptoms, you know. And then panic attacks, never knew what they were. And then when you start having panic attacks on stage, like one of the safest places to be, and you start having panic attacks and then agoraphobia, you can't go out the door or anything like that. Whoa, time to relax and take it easy.
Well,
just on the, would I go back on stage now? Probably not, because I don't like to see old rock and rollers. I think it's kind of sad.
Yeah.
I don't want to see men in their 60s with their big beer bellies staggering around, balding, staggering around on stage with wobbly old fellas' voices, you know. Mm. I'd much rather see somebody of of 21 with a bit of fire and a bit of energy, because it's a wine best served young, I think.
Yeah, great line. Pick another song. Another XTC gem written by Andy Partridge. Anything you fancy? What should we have next?
The first thing I ever wrote on a keyboard. We had a device, a quite magical device called a Mellotron. And we bought a Mellotron, and nobody had any room to look after the Mellotron. So it was like, Andy, you've got a spare bedroom. You stick that in your spare bedroom. I can play pretty much anything on a guitar. But as a keyboard player, I'm like two bunches of bananas, you know, dropped onto the keys. And, you know, you're talking to the man who used to have a cardboard hand.
Cardboard hand.
I had a cardboard hand. If I found a great shape on the keys, I'd run into the kitchen and would find a bit of cardboard, holding my hand in that shape, and draw round my fingers with a marker pen. And then I knew that that was the first chord of the song. You know, I had no other way of, because I didn't know how to. I'm not a taught musician. No. I don't. Music is a gut thing with me. It's not in my head really. But anyway, I was looking after this Mellotron, and it sounded to me like the seaside. And basically, that's how I write songs. I think, what does that music sound like? What does that sound remind me of? And then in the process of describing to myself what it sounded like, oh, it's like a seaside sound. It's like something you might hear on a pier, but it sounds a bit desolate and a bit foggy. And it's foggy because it's winter and the seaside is all shut down. So it's all a bit sad and dreamlike. And before you know it, you've got the lyrics to the song, because you're telling yourself what it sounds like. And I write most of my songs like that. And it's a song called Seagull Screaming Kisser Kisser. And I was very proud of it.
But out of reach, though.
It's the Alan Thompson Show here on BBC Radio Wales. Andy Partridge from XTC is my special guest on the programme tonight, chatting about his lengthy career in music. We're having a cup of tea together in his front room in his house in Swindon. You're still writing all the time now, Andy?
I do. I'm making the terrible, terrible blunder of trying to write for other people. And it's a career that doesn't seem to be working. And I can tell you, I just finished with an English chap who lives in Hollywood, a fellow called Chris Braid, and we wrote four songs for Sarah Brightman. I've only heard yesterday that she doesn't like them, so I'm stuck with this bunch of songs that I think only Sarah Brightman could sing, and she's not interested in them, you know. So I can't really see. You know, I can't really see Paolo Nuttini doing them. I had a space. I wrote some songs. I wrote him 15 songs, actually. Miles Kane. He did three of them on his album.
If you're writing for Miles Kane, do you sit down and try and write a song in his particular fashion?
Yeah, absolutely. He said to me, I can't really do the accent, but Andy, I want a bunch of mod stompers. That's all I want is mod stompers. So I thought, right, mod stompers. So I would get a bunch of songs together that I thought were kind of mod stompers. And I'd say, what do you think to this song? You know, they'd be things like Dance to the Music by Sly and the Family Stone. Great mod stomper, in my opinion. Or some Small Faces stuff, you know, real good mod stomper. And then, what do you think to this? What do you think to that? And if he said, oh, I really like that, really like that. What I'd do is I'd take the drum rhythms from any given song that he liked. Because I'm pretty decent with drum rhythms, and I'd reprogram them into a computer, and I'd then rewrite something in the style of, well, I quite fancy, what if I make it a bit Small Faces, but we'll do it over the Dance to the Music rhythm, or he really likes this song by so-and-so, so I'll do something using the kind of chords and melody that he would do, or that they would do, over this other drum rhythm for another band. But he really likes that drum tempo, you know. He really liked the Jeepster. So I took the took the drum rhythms from that, the drumming and conga playing, programmed them as near as I could get them.
Did I read somewhere talking about writing songs that you nearly wrote with Brian Wilson?
I nearly did, except Brian Wilson doesn't know who the hell I am. His management called up one evening and said, you know, could you get in touch, because we think you'd be great working with Brian. And you know, and there's a lot of Brian Wilson in my writing. He's one of my big influences, along with Lennon and McCartney, Ray Davis, Bacharach and David. But I was rather flattered to be asked that I might like to work with Brian Wilson. And I called a few people that had worked with Brian Wilson. They had some tricky stories to tell, including one chap who shall remain nameless that flew out to LA, and Brian Wilson never spoke to him for the first 3 days they were together. And in fact, the only words he said in his direction was at a dinner where Brian Wilson said, "I like ice cream, do you?" And that was it. And the fella then got on the plane and came home. So I was a little bit put off of, would I, you know, does Brian Wilson need to work with me, and is it going to be a little difficult? They said he'll contact you after his current tour is finished, but the call never came. So when the Beach Boys recently came and did their 50th shows, they said, would you like to come along to the Albert Hall? And I don't usually go to gigs. I'm not a gig person. And Erica said, look, we've got to go, you know. You've got to see the Beach Boys if you've never seen them live. Okay, all right. So we went and saw the Beach Boys, and I was introduced to Brian Wilson, who had absolutely no idea who I was. But it was nice to see the Beach Boys.
I remember you telling me years ago that I think you were recording at Air Studios at the same time that Paul McCartney was recording at Air Studios, working with Ringo Starr. And weren't they coming towards you in a corridor? And you had to, well, you tell me the story. Well, it was too, you bolted.
I did. I wasn't ready to meet a Beatle. We were, you know, you got to work up to it. And McCartney especially. Yeah, we were mixing in air studios in Oxford Street.
Oxford Street.
Yeah, yeah, it was on the corner of Oxford Street and Regent Street. That big crossroads there, top of the top of the building there. And I heard that McCartney and Ringo were doing the music to Give My Regards to Broad Street in the studio down the corridor, you know. And I came out to go to the loo one tea time or whatever, and got in the corridor, and coming up the corridor was Paul McCartney and Linda. And you couldn't avoid them because this corridor was really narrow, you know. And I thought, oh no, what do I do? And he came towards me, and they were going home. It must have been about 6 o'clock, you know, they were knocking off at 6 o'clock. They were coming towards me, and he looked up, and he just sort of, all right, you know. And I thought, oh, I'm not ready for this. And I just barged into the nearest studio, which was across the hall, and the group Japan were in there. But I just barged in there, and, oh, sorry, lads, wrong studio, sorry, sorry. I needed to be psyched up to meet one of my big heroes, yeah. You know. But I did meet Ringo.
Didn't you steal one of his drumsticks?
Well, actually, I think the same evening that I bottled out of meeting McCartney, I said to Colin, you know, they've been jamming in there all afternoon trying to find some music for Give My Regards to Broad Street, I think. And I said, you fancy going and have a look at their setup, you know. So that we knew they'd gone home because they all went home at like 6, you know, very sensible, very, very sensible thing to do. So Colin and I snuck in the studio and saw Ringo's semicircular leather cushion with, it was cream leather with Ringo in red on it, red leather, which is very, very swish. And I saw he had a mismatched pair of drumsticks, and I thought, oh, you know, I'm not really a thief, but I would love a pair of Ringo's drumsticks. Cool. And I looked in his bag of drumsticks, and he had about 50 drumsticks in there. So I thought, well, he's not going to miss two. And I lifted them up, and they were a mismatched pair. So I pulled out the corresponding mismatched pair from the bag, and I noticed he'd been drumming with them all afternoon, and they were all messed up, you know, with rim shots, and they were chewed up.
Yeah.
So I got a key out of my pocket and messed them up with a key. They're like shavings everywhere, you know, with my front door key. Led those on the snare drum, took the pair that were on the snare drum and put them in my back pocket. I went over to McCartney's bass setup, and he had a load of big white triangular plectrums. And he thought, well, he's got a huge pile of these plectrums. He wouldn't miss one. Go into a good home, you know. So I helped myself to one of his plectrums, which I've since lost.
Oh.
But I've still got Ringo's drumstick.
Still got the drum kit?
Yeah.
The drumstick?
Yeah, I didn't go for the whole kit because I couldn't replace it, you know. But I did meet Ringo a while afterwards, and I in this The Spirit of the Forest record.
Yeah.
And he was in the control room, and I went over to him, and I said, look, I've got something terrible to confess. I actually nicked a pair of your drumsticks while you were in Air Studios. And ever the great comedian, he just stared down at his very expensive watch and rapidly covered it with his hand as if I was going to whip it off of his wrist, you know. He was all right about it. He said no problem. Yeah. But
I remember finally you once told me a good story that what was Sting's telephone number? Because you used to be big buddies with the police, didn't you? You used to tour with them. And didn't you tell me that Sting had a one-digit telephone number?
He lived in Ireland at the time, tax exile, I think, and his telephone number was 3. And, he said, Partridge, if you fancy a chat, give us a ring. If you ring this village up, there'll be an old biddy there, she'll answer, because it comes through the post office late, and just say you want number 3, that's me. Hello there, now, how can I help you now? And I'd say, well, I'll have 3, please. And you could hear this clattering, and it's basically an old biddy with some, you know. And he'd plug me into number 3, and Mr. Sting had answered. So, that was his phone number, was 3.
Oh, that's funny. Have you kept in touch with Sting?
Haven't, actually. I think Sting moves in rarefied circles these days. He doesn't live in Swindon.
Let's have a final XTC gem.
Possibly the song where, and I've got to be a bit immodest now, but it's the only way I can talk about it. The song where I think I got near to almost as being as good as my musical heroes. You know, the Beatles, the Beach Boys, the Kinks. These people that I idolized as a kid, and I thought, I want to be able to write and make records that good. And I think this song almost gets in the ballpark. It's a song called Easter Theatre.
Gold sun rolls around, chocolate nipple brown, tumble from your arms like the ground. Your breasts swell and awake from sleep. Hairs will kick and leap, flowers climb erect, smiling from the moist kiss of her rainbow mouth. Stage.
The wonderful XTC from 1999, that was Easter Theatre, as chosen by the man who wrote it, the wonderful Andy Partridge. Good to see Andy again. And a look out for his latest projects. There's loads of them. He's always on the go.